Welcome everyone in this new episode of the series Repairing the Future, organized by Bozar in Brussels. Today we will have a conversation with Dutch architect Rem Koolhaas, who is not only known for his buildings and his architecture produced by the office for by his Office for Metropolitan Architecture, but who has also been a public intellectual, heavily influencing and profoundly influencing the cultural debate around architecture. So, for example, in 2016, a few years ago, he curated the Venice Architecture Biennale and later on published the book Elements of Architecture. In 2000, he co-curated with, of course, with collaborators, the exhibition Mutations, about changes in the contemporary city. In 1995, the book Small, Medium, Large, Extra Large was published, which is one of the most well-known and also one of the most visibly present architecture books of the 20th century. And then in 1978, he debuted as an architectural writer or as an architect with the book Delirious New York, a retroactive manifesto for Manhattan, in which he explored and often very engagingly wrote about the architectural possibilities and potentialities present in a city like New York. His most recent project, again a collaborative project with AMO, the think tank related to the Office for Metropolitan Architecture, is an exhibition at the Guggenheim Museum in New York that opened on February the 22nd, but unfortunately, like most exhibitions, had to close a few weeks later. The exhibition is entitled Countryside, the Future, and Laura is in a way one of the few people who has been able to visit the exhibition.
So ever since Delirious New York was published, you've been considered a visionary of metropolitan life. Maybe that's a good place to start, to ask you how come that an architect and urbanist suddenly decides to focus on farmland?
I should say that the word visionary I've always thought was completely misplaced. And also I would have an argument with the word suddenly. I don't think I suddenly kind of started to look at farmland. I actually have experienced farmland in my youth. I've never ignored farmland, but I've experienced it as a kind of private person. But it is true that in the last 10 years, I became more and more interested in basically the current status, or maybe it's better to say lack of status and lack of definition of what I call the countryside. And I think it is very important to kind of really say that this is in the context of a particular prognosis. The prognosis is launched by the UN, which is kind of suggesting, or which noted that already in 2007, that half of mankind lived in cities, but that predicted that by 2050, it might be 70 or 80%. And so therefore, I'm interested in two things. I'm interested in the lack of status of the countryside, the lack of definition, but also in the future of the countryside, if, as seems plausible, it will have to be inhabited by half of the people that live there now. And that was, for me, the driving force behind the entire project.
Okay. And could you perhaps explain a little bit more how you define the countryside in relationship to the city? Do you see them as strict dichotomies, or do they also inform each other?
No, I think that the exhibition is kind of basically very diverse, and also has is looking at certain episodes in nature. And what I think was kind of very important conclusion that is one of the basis of the show is that even in the middle of the 20th century, almost any country, almost any kind of politician. Kind of worthy of the name, both authoritarian but also democratic, had a vision for the countryside and would be able or was able to define the city and the countryside and the kind of relationship between them. And what we are facing now is a complete absence of that definition. Implicitly, I think there is a critique of neoliberalism for causing that, let's say, definition, absence of definition, where we cannot even say whether it's a contrast or whether it's an extension or whether it's complementary or whether it's a colony. All of those definitions apply to some extent, but there is no kind of overriding concept anymore.
Okay, and maybe
I can also say that by definition, and that kind of relates to my nervousness about the word visionary. I did not pretend to, and do not pretend to be able to provide that definition again, partly because the incredible variety of conditions that would be extremely difficult to capture, you know, in a single framework, and also because I think kind of right now it's very important to be super skeptical of any claim to definition, any claim to coherent philosophy, and to simply be systematic in questioning kind of everything. So basically, it's a kind of large questioning with an awareness that it also leaves open many questions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's true that the exhibition is more built up based on global samples from all ideologies and continents. So there's a wide variety of narratives. Could you maybe say something about how you tackle such a vast territory and subject? How you started to process to research a countryside?
We were invited by the Guggenheim to do a show, and that was the kind of moment that we spent maybe kind of 1 or 2 years to strategize whether it would be even responsible to pretend to show a global condition. And so what we settled on was to be kind of present, be able to report from kind of local, highly local kind of situations in all continents and in all kind of relevant and maybe, you know, current ideological systems, and to create an amalgamation or a kind of panorama in a certain way of conditions, both conditions in nature, conditions in the preservation of nature, conditions that are seriously defined by climate change, and also looking at a number of new technologies and how they potentially interact with the countryside. So it's both a panorama in terms of very diverse conditions, diverse political systems, diverse economic systems, with in the end perhaps a conviction that all together they are representative samples that give you at least a first insight in the complexity of the countryside situation.
Maybe I was wondering, do you have the impression that in this reportage that you made, that the developments are hopeful or alarming, or is it more a kind of neutral position that you wanted to take towards what's going on right now at the countryside?
Let's talk about the word neutral first. Mm-hmm. It's definitely not a neutral position. For instance, there has been a kind of pretty controversial aspect of the show where I referred to it initially, we show kind of political involvement and preoccupation with the countryside in the 20th century, And there we were careful to kind of represent three authoritarian systems, Hitler, Stalin and Mao, and three democratic systems, Fourier, but also a kind of German visionary, Schlegel, and Franklin Roosevelt, and Sigmund Mansholt, or the EU. And it's kind of very interesting that kind of basically all critics interpreted that as a kind of hidden affinity with authoritarian systems, but actually we showed kind of a careful 50-50 balance. But we also showed, for instance, and that for me is a kind of very important and fascinating aspect of the show, that the initial transformation of the EU and the initial transformation of the agricultural policies of the EU coincided exactly with the period of Mao's Great Leap Forward. And therefore, you know, in the EU, at some point, even used or generated the same aesthetic as the Great Leap Forward. And kind of rather than seeing this that as a kind of a hidden Eurocentrism, I would say it was a deliberate attempt to look at Europe with Chinese eyes.
Okay. This section was called Political Redesign, and it followed a different part called Otium to Wellness, which spans a much longer period of time, 2,000 years, and which focuses on classic Chinese-Roman views of nature and agro-pastoral activities. There's a lot of emphasis placed on the political redesign, but I wondered if you could tell us what we could learn from those ancient times, the period that comes before.
Well, I think that maybe that is a kind of relevant. Of course, we're now talking in the kind of period of COVID. Although I want to kind of really avoid kind of suggesting that the countryside acquired a new kind of relevance kind of through COVID, I think that particularly the kind of period of China, the kind of Roman period, and I would even say the kind of Italy until the kind of Renaissance, was a period that agriculture was kind of very close to intellectual life and was a kind of stimulant or a beginning of intellectual life, and that a lot of the kind of most important communication, the most important enjoyment, the deepest experience of life was considered to happen in the countryside, and for me, and basically both in China, in the Roman period, but all of course also in the kind of Renaissance, in kind of farms such as conceived by Palladio and other architects, I think the essence of life is located in the countryside. And I think that is something that today could be very inspiring. We've seen that kind of through COVID, you know, anyone who can is escaping to their second homes on Long Island. But that is, of course, not the true engagement or the true experience of the countryside that Romans and the Chinese initiated.
Mm-hmm. I was wondering, since the series here is called Repairing the Future, if there isn't a danger in when we decide to look at the countryside and maybe to develop the countryside, to make the same mistakes, let's say, in terms of humanity that we made before. So are there strategies, or do you think there are main strategies that we absolutely have to avoid now that we would take a second look at the countryside?
Well, I think that you are right. There is a danger, and not only is there a danger, but there is currently an absolute practice of taking the countryside for granted and seeing the countryside kind of simply as a potential extension of kind of urban life. We see it everywhere. You know, every kind of city claims constantly kind of new territories, new communities, new for extension. And we even see, for instance, in Belgium and the Netherlands, that kind of right now each village has its own periphery and is kind of selling out its own periphery, and kind of therefore is simply consuming the surrounding territory. And what I've been criticized for calling the exhibition, or saying that the exhibition dealt with an ignored realm. And of course it is true that, you know, there are kind of hundreds and thousands of kind of people who have been kind of working the countryside, working on the countryside, thinking about the countryside. But what I wanted to suggest with that is that we nevertheless are collectively guilty of taking the countryside for granted as if it is there and as if it is not and as if it is not being consumed. And what I have kind of shown in the show is that at certain kind of moments it's drastically being consumed, and that large part of those consumptions are actually to support urban life and to sustain urban life. So I think it's not only the fear, a kind of fear of gentrification, or I don't know whether it means something to you, Wienerswijk, which is kind of simply kind of new housing, which is kind of in neoliberalism kind of simply made very often without the kind of required common and communal facilities or social facilities, is kind of constant growth. So it's that is not only the danger, but there is an even larger danger that kind of at greater distances and in remote locations, you see extremely harsh transformations of nature into industrial complexes.
Mm-hmm. Because one of the very basic things about basic problems of big cities today is that it's extremely expensive to live there, and you could say that is sort of a basic advantage of the periphery or the countryside, that it's still quite cheap to be housed over there, and that is something maybe the danger of development also entails, that kind of what you call gentrification, that in the end the countryside will become in the same way, let's say, exclusive and expensive as the cities are today?
Well, as I said, they already are. Long Island is a kind of very good kind of example. But on the other hand, there's so much territory that is kind of abandoned and so much territory that has a kind of very insecure kind of status, that I would not, I see that kind of gentrification and this apparent fatality that development means greater inequality and you know, all the kind of things that we have now exhaustively kind of inventorized as effects of neoliberalism, that they cannot be avoided in kind of many cases. And actually, that was for me one of the kind of interesting kind of projects that is also shown in the exhibition, how entire German abandoned German villages could be reanimated by refugees, and how that reanimation has nothing to do with gentrification, but kind of simply enabling struggling people in not necessarily very kind of open societies to establish their own foothold in a new new environment. And maybe that is also kind of very important. There are two things I would like to kind of raise. The exhibition is reopening in October and will be in New York until the end of February. And also that this project is kind of really an extensive collaboration with a number of other authors that are also represented in the catalog, and with a number of institutions in both America, in the Netherlands, Wageningen University, Nairobi University in Africa, and CAFA, Chinese Academy of Fine Arts in Beijing. And in that sense, I think one of the kind of bizarre consequences of notoriety or kind of fame is that kind of suddenly work that is shared by many people is kind of simply considered as a kind of personal statement, although in this particular case it was kind of very careful to mobilize knowledge locally and not to impose it.
You mentioned Belgium. I guess, well, it's a country you know quite well. One thing you could say about Belgium is that it doesn't have a countryside, that we are this kind of completely semi-urbanized area with suburbia and with cities, but not with a real countryside anymore. Is that true? And is it, I guess it's a difference with the Netherlands, or is there?
Well, I think that there's a large part of the Netherlands which where you could make the same analysis. But even there, I would to some extent question that analysis, because even in the kind of most densest kind of sections between, let's say, kind of what between Amsterdam and Antwerp or Amsterdam and Brussels, if you turn off the main road and if you then turn off one more kind of road, you find yourself in kind of in environments and architectural ensembles that really look as if time has been frozen, you know, in certain cases for centuries. So I think that, you know, we have no countryside is kind of really a typical comment from the kind of urban bubble. I'm not accusing you personally, but from the urban bubble that we all kind of more or less inhabit.
Mm-hmm. There has been in recent years a quite heavily mediatized debate in Belgium concerning, again, what you could call this urban bubble and the importance of the ecological reasons for living in cities rather than in the countryside or in the periphery. Do you think that is? Have you followed those debates? And do you? What is your position?
Of course. Of course, you know, as an architect, you kind of basically have to follow any debate.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's a kind of very unstable profession at this moment. You know, on the one hand, it has its 5,000-year-old history. But on the other hand, it is submitted to extremely diverse kind of new forces that on one hand force it either to adjustment or to kind of resistance. And therefore, you know, any debate is inevitably kind of part of any of your next steps. And yes, theoretically, I follow the kind of argument that living densely in highly sophisticated technical environments that take sustainability very seriously, and that kind of through their very density are able to save energy or to channel or to recycle kind of more efficiently, blah, blah, blah. I follow that argument, but the problem is, and that may be also kind of problem of neoliberalism, that there is kind of very rarely the kind of political will to support the costs that you know, theoretically optimum implies. And therefore, I've become a little bit more skeptical of that. So I still believe that theoretically it is an argument that is true. But I've become more skeptical that in the current situation, it will be able, we will be able to realize that. And this is maybe a kind of moment where I can also kind of engage with the issue of the so-called smart city. There is a kind of problem with you know, this theoretical position in the extent that it has been kind of hijacked by tech companies that are selling to more or less sophisticated kind of cities and communities. The idea that, you know, only through even deeper relationship with technology, sensors, internet, blah, 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 that kind of situation can be achieved. So that skepticism, double skepticism, is for me one of the reasons also to look at the potential of inhabiting the countryside in a less in an intelligent way.
One of the main topics of this series is the importance of art, culture, architecture. I'm not, of course, I'm at the risk of sort of simplifying what you said, but there is, one can wonder if architects or artists or intellectuals at the moment are quite powerless, because we first have to change political systems, and we first have to fight the power of big companies. And as long as there's still this kind of political disinterest or this political crisis, and at the same time these enormously powerful big tech companies, there is, one could argue, very little that architects or well, let's say people like us can do. Is that another opinion from a metropolitan bubble, or what do you think?
I would say that's a kind of opinion of a kind of European bubble. Mm-hmm. You're both in Brussels. I have an almost mystical faith, and maybe that is. Maybe that is the best definition of it in Europe, and also not in terms of prolongation of Eurocentric kind of confidence, but on the contrary, all in Europe as a continent that would be able or is able to adapt in an intelligent way to a new environment. And to new challenges, and I think that, for instance, you know, the way you talk about politics as if it is kind of one big tragic mess in which a kind of well-thinking person has no role to play is, for me, very dangerous. Because you know that we have a European Commissioner Timmermans who has been kind of working on a Green Deal, which is a kind of very serious kind of effort that you can probably criticize for many ways, but definitely not criticize in terms of its aims and ambitions. And I would think that, you know, architects, but intellectuals and maybe even artists have a genuine interest in kind of supporting that kind of thing, rather than writing off politics as if it is a kind of irrelevant field for the moment.
Yes, to return back to the exhibition, you've stated quite explicitly that it's not an art exhibition nor an architecture exhibition. Why is that? And do you see a role for architecture in the countryside? Also in relation with the pandemic, you mentioned Corona earlier on. There is a very clear link between the pandemic and climate change and unsustainable agricultural practices. And I wondered if architects could have a role in that.
Yeah, well, I think that In kind of some of your earlier questions, there is also the introduction of a kind of generational question. I think I'm obviously a child of the 60s. But one aspect of the 60s that I think is not kind of particularly kind of remembered at this point is that the 60s was a period of extreme ecological consciousness, of extremely kind of creative and relevant ecological thinking and writing. And that kind of a lot of that writing took place or was done by architects. There is a series of heroes. Buckminster Fuller is one of them. You probably know the kind of metaphor Spaceship Earth. That was a kind of extremely important and still highly relevant, you know, if you ignore the kind of rhetoric, still highly kind of relevant conception. And there is kind of, you know, at least five other names I could name for that. And so I think that it's very limiting to expect architects to kind of produce architecture only, because I think it's one profession that has always taken the liberty to also comment on seemingly kind of a field seemingly outside its mandate. And in that sense, I'm simply, you know, operating within the tradition, well-established tradition, that you would be kind of start with Vitruvius and probably even earlier.
Okay. One of the overlooked roles of the open spaces are the ones that where there's automated factories and data operation centers for companies such as Amazon, Apple, and Google. You address those kind of open spaces in the section about post-human architectures. I was wondering if the role for architects could not be also to make people less dependent on those technologies and also encourage them to self-organize rather to be dependent on machines and post-human architectures?
This is a kind of really beautiful suggestion, but it's not difficult for me to kind of imagine that, you know, if I started to encourage people to self-organize, the howls of laughter, irritation and contempt that would kind of generate. So if you can tell me how somebody like me could do that, I would be happy to comply. I'm a very, in my daily life, I practice it to a very high degree, but also I think that there is a section in the show, which is about a section in Nevada where there are seemingly randomly kind of placed enormous boxes that could either be factories or data centers or distribution centers that are buildings that are kind of bigger than ever have been built before and that are now occupying already an area that is kind of bigger than Manhattan. And so there again, I saw my role not necessarily as kind of somebody kind of warning against the Tesla batteries, because Tesla batteries may be actually kind of part of what mankind needs if it is will be continued to drive. But I saw my role here as kind of exploring the implications of this kind of condition, because the space between these two boxes is still called a street, although that area bigger than Manhattan will not be kind of inhabited by more than a handful of people. So is a space inhabited by a handful full of people and by a few robots, is that still public space? Does it still deserve the name street? Does it still need graphics? Does it still need traffic lights, et cetera, et cetera? So I was kind of really exploring the implication. And in all these questions, the implication is in a way exacerbated by the fact that the countryside is poorly inhabited right now, but it's in the future, in the near future, in the next 20 years, half of the people will even disappear. That's why I also in the show there is this kind of section on Fukushima, where we did not only look at the reactor, but also at a nearby enormous kind of field of concrete, where Japan is testing the possibility that kind of certain sections of the territory could be completely abandoned by population, but would still necessarily contain some infrastructure, such as a road or a bridge, and is investigating how kind of robots could sustain life there after human beings have disappeared. So it's not necessarily a kind of enthusiasm for, you know, those kind of conditions, or a kind of heartless and cynical kind of look at those conditions, but it's really a serious investigation. Okay, what are the implications? If this happens, what will happen to architecture? What will happen to language? What will happen to experiences?
Mm-hmm. It's true that the exhibition doesn't really present the future, but more signs of the future in the present. One of the projects I found quite striking is pixel farming, which looks quite futuristic, but it's happening right now. It's being investigated by the Wageningen University. And what struck me is that it really bridges the organic and the synthetic, the traditional and the futuristic. And that's a quite interesting way of thinking about farming. Do you think it's really possible to scale up farming? So scale up for, I mean, scale in a sustainable way?
But what I think is important to kind of say there, it's a project by Lenora Ditzler, an American woman who is studying in Wageningen, and who kind of present this as a kind of feminist concept. And so that might be kind of one of the strands or one of the components of our kind of future, kind of stronger role and stronger voice and stronger participation in innovation of women with an explicit feminist agenda, which obviously and in many cases then takes the resurrection of the earth or the good the use of the earth, or the optimum use of the earth, as its ambition. Mm-hmm. And yes, she. It's obviously an experiment, but theoretically, the experiment so far kind of shows that you could generate the same quantities with a fraction of the fertilizer, or even no fertilizer and no poison. So if that is true, it's a kind of very hopeful sign.
Okay.
It might relate to a rather, again, maybe a more traditional view of the architect, but you could say that an architect makes projects and in the sense, or is in that sense always speaking about the future, because you make a very specific plan for to be realized or not, that depends. Is that something that you also do or think of doing for the countryside, to make this very, let's say, to make plans, architectural plans for the countryside?
We're definitely trying. Yeah, and I think that, you know, in this group of maybe 20 people, you know, that. Kind of were together responsible for the show, including kind of African women in Kenya. All of us are looking for opportunities, and kind of some of us are kind of actually finding opportunities. But of course, that is the interesting thing of this moment. In neoliberalism, there is almost no public client anymore. And that is kind of really a serious problem, because it means that and almost anything you want to do, you need to convince a commercial party or a party that has some other interest than kind of simply the well-being of human beings at the core of their values. So we're all trying, and I think many of us are kind of finding things, but I cannot say that I've found a direct correlation, but I'm definitely trying. And at that point, yes, it would be interesting to begin to develop a vision. Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
But I've been very open, and again, that was not a kind of cynicism, but simply an openness. I've been very open, with about all the kind of forces at this point that make the word vision an almost unsustainable word.
Mm-hmm. Maybe this relates well to what you mentioned earlier, the problem of generations or the difference between generations. You actually started out as a journalist and then decided to focus on architecture. This is, of course, a very hypothetical question, but do you think that same move would be, if you were growing up today, would continue to be imaginable, given also the fact that the absence of public commissioners?
You mean, what do you mean, the same switch, or?
Yes, I mean, imagine you were born 20 years ago and you're a young person, you look around and you think, what can I do? Would architecture be a vocation or something that you...
Well, I think that, it's an interesting question. If I were 20 today, then if I had the ambition to become a journalist, I would first have to go to a journalism school and spend 4 years there. And then I might have an opportunity to, to either write or to appear in media. And basically, I would already have an investment that would make it probably harder to decide to throw all of that away and to start a new kind of onerous study. The one advantage, I think, kind of regardless of all our kind of wrong-headed sense of entitlement, that I would say as a 60s person is the incredible accessibility that was, and changeability, flexibility that existed at the time. I became a journalist because I wrote a letter to the editor of a newspaper that I had failed my baccalaureate and that I wanted to work for them. And basically the next week she wrote back and said, come and see me. And the next week I was, writing for the paper.
Mm-hmm.
And so that enabled kind of obviously this kind of shift between different kind of professions and different roles.
Yeah, but maybe the role of architect already in the 60s was heavily linked to institutions. So for that you had to study in London at the Architectural Association to become an architect.
Yeah. But there even there I was also kind of relatively flexible because I didn't finish it and kind of went to America with a grant before I finished the architectural school, and that was also kind of something that kind of was quite possible and not not kind of really problematic. But I can have a different question. Particularly through my involvement in Wageningen University and kind of seeing the kind of thinking, but also the experiments that were taking place there, and seeing the incredible knowledge that is accumulated and that is latent in the kind of countryside, and that in our urban bubble we rarely look at. I would be very tempted. Would have been very tempted to study there. And I'm even tempted now to continue collaboration with it.
Yeah. I was also wondering about how you looked at the younger generations that today are already very convinced that there are climate solutions to the global problem, but that politicians should take action and don't really do it. Greta Thunberg is one of the main figures, of course, and she's also featured in the exhibition in relation to the Hambach Forest debate. Do you believe in her generation's strategies?
Yeah, which more is basically the strategy of activism. Do you think that you could have the impression that certainly for generations even younger than us, that activism is now the only way out,
yes,
exactly to ask for change and to urge people in power to...
Well, I think she's been undeniably, unbelievably effective. And so in that sense, I'm both impressed and you know, kind of... I'm extremely hoping very strongly that they will find, the generation will find kind of way not only to continue the activism, but also to kind of participate in politics in kind of way which doesn't, by definition, which is not necessarily based on contempt for politics. I think We are all guilty at reducing in our own heads the kind of role and the status of politicians. You know, in our rhetoric, in our kind of intimate conversations, in all of those kind of situations, we have denigrated kind of politicians, and now we are stuck with the kind of world of denigrated politics. So it has to be kind of reinvented. And if Greta is part of that, so much better. And that would be absurd if that became, you know, the kind of generational contest, because I think that it should be a generational kind of cement.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Maybe, of course, a topic that came back a lot during these conversations at Beaux-Arts was the coronavirus and the way that it sort of forced or enabled us all to sort of take a break, let's say. And you could say that the year 2020 and possibly even further on will be a year in which some things became possible and others became impossible. How did you experience this period, or continue to experience this period?
Well, I think that probably more or less exactly like you both, extremely kind of welcome focus on domestic environment and the basis of life. And that was a beautiful experience until kind of maybe a few weeks ago, because I think that kind of right now I am also feeling the intense need to communicate, and not only to communicate kind of electronically, but also to see with my own eyes again kind of how different situations, different people, and to interact in a kind of physical way. Mm-hmm. I'm in a way enjoying how that becomes more complex. For instance, I'm traveling in Europe by car, and that is again a very interesting therapy in terms of not skipping from hub to hub, but actually doing the time and exploring the kind of worlds and the different conditions. Mm-hmm. So yes, I think that it can be used in a certain way, but I don't think it is the end of communication in the flesh.
Mm-hmm. And well, it might be again a question that defines you or that provokes from you a visionary statement, but do you think there will be lasting changes from this crisis?
Well, Basically, I think that what is the lasting change?
Yeah, that's a good question. But let's say
the contradiction in terms.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's definitely changing everything, but for that reason, it cannot last. But anyway, sorry, it's maybe a kind of word game, but I think it will have some impact, but I'm not sure, simply not sure yet, if that impact will be kind of ultimately very deep.
Mm-hmm.
I hope so, but I'm not sure.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Rem Koolhaas, for this wonderful conversation that also showed, I think, a lot of potential and sort of open-ended view or regarding the future. So thank you very much. And
thank you
so everyone.
It's really
for
interesting to talk to Brussels again.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.